We're going to use three panels in particular today, the swatches panel, the color panel, and the gradient panel. And so if you don't have those panels open already, what you can do is go to the window and then click on each one of those. So the color, the swatches, and the gradient. And so you can kind of tear them off from here too. You can see here, if I click on gradient, it opens the gradient panel. And you can actually tear that out of there and have it floating above the rest of your workspace. Since I have to show it up on the screen here, I don't have a lot of room, so I like to keep them grouped on the side. But you can have them floating, or you can have them off to the side. And so make sure that you go ahead and have the gradient, the color, and the swatches all open on the side so you can have easy access to them when we use them later. And so a couple of other useful panels that I always have open are the stroke and the align, because I use these all the time. I don't think I'm going to actually use them in particular today, but they're useful to have around. So the first thing that we're going to go over today is the pin tool. And the pin tool is like one of the most powerful tools in Illustrator, but it's also really the hardest one to master. So the pin tool, really what it does is it draws paths by placing anchor points on your artwork, and then it automatically connects those anchor points with paths. And when you single click and just release the mouse, it drops an anchor point, and that is a corner point. Whereas if you single click, hold, and drag, that makes a smooth corner, a smooth anchor point. And I'll show you what that means. So I'm going to select the pin tool. It looks like this. The shortcut's P. If I click, that puts down an anchor point. Let's see. If I click again, it draws a corner point. You can see that it makes a sharp edge, a corner. All right, now if I want to close that path, if I move my cursor over the first point, you'll see that there's a tiny little circle next to the pin tool now. If you do that right now, you'll see there's a circle that appears next to the pin tool if you move the mouse towards the first anchor point. And so if you click that, then that closes the path. All right? And so that's helpful if you're going to apply a fill to that path. Right, then that color will be contained within the path, right? All right, so now let's look what happens if we switch back to the select tool and deselect the path that we just made, and we're going to start a brand new path. So I'm going to switch to select with V, click outside so that nothing's selected, and then I'm going to hit P again to start a new path with the pin tool. So this time I'm going to make smooth corners. And instead of just single clicking and letting go, I'm going to hold the mouse, and then I'm going to drag. All right, so I'll put the first point, and then I'm going to click and drag. And you can see what happens are these little handles appear outside of the anchor point. And where I move that handle, then the shape of the path moves in the direction of the handle. And so when I click again, the path will be smooth and in the direction of the handles that are appearing outside of the anchor point. Does anybody have any questions about how that works? Just click, hold the mouse, and drag into the direction of the curve you want to go. Now, sometimes you want the curve to go in a direction that's not the same, not a straight line. So you see that the path is going backwards towards one handle and then forwards towards the other. You can actually break the two handles apart from each other if you hold down Alt. And now you can move the two handles independently of each other. And so I'll keep holding Alt, and I'll release the mouse, and now the two handles are not in a straight line, they're broken from each other. And so now the path will follow both of the handles and go kind of in opposite directions. And so this is like one of the hardest things to do just hearing it the first time. What you need to do is you need to click on some paths, and you need to click and drag and just see how it works. And it really can take months of using this tool to really get the hang of it. But then there are also three other tools that are hidden underneath the pin tool. And those are the add anchor point tool, the subtract anchor point tool, and then the convert anchor point tool. And so rather than having to go back and select them from the palette, you can actually access them all by using modifier keys along with the pin tool. So I'm going to start drawing a new path again by switching to select with V, clicking outside the path, and then going back to the pin tool. All right, so now I'm primed to start a new path. So I'm going to click for the first point, and then I'm going to drag, right, to make a curved path. Now I can access the direct select tool by holding down control. So actually it's going to access the last selection tool that I just used. And so there's actually a trick to switch between the selection tools, I think. No, let's start over, sorry guys. So let's start with the direct select tool, selected A for direct select. And then switch to the pin tool, P. So I use the direct select tool with A, then switch to the P for the pin tool. And now you can see I'm drawing a path. I keep drawing the path. But now if I hold down command or control, the arrow has changed to the direct select tool. And now I can move those anchor points around because I have the direct select tool. So this is just a little trick that you may be using the pin tool someday in the future when you're a pin tool wizard. You might want to remember these little tricks. So you can actually access the convert anchor point tool by holding down Alt. I guess it would make sense to have it out of the way of the modifier key there. So you can see when I'm holding Alt, the pin tool has changed to the convert anchor point tool. And so now when I click on anchor points, rather than doing the pin tool on it, it's converting. And so I can move the anchor point around, or if I single click on the anchor point, I can convert it from a smooth anchor point to a corner anchor point. All right, and then the final trick I'm going to teach you about the pin tool is that when you've clicked and started dragging, if you hold space, you can move that anchor point around. Maybe you decided it wasn't in exactly the right spot that you wanted. So I'm going to hold space, move it around, and then I can continue to edit it at the same time. So to recap, direct select with the command or control key, convert anchor point with the Alt key, and then hold space to move a point after you put it down. All right, and so I've created some curved paths for you at the bottom of the worksheet here. And what you can do is you can use the pin tool to either add or subtract anchor points and see exactly how that works. Or you can use the convert anchor point tool, which is Shift-C, and you can click on one of those anchor points and see how when you move the handles, it will change the shape of the curve. All right, and you probably are trying to put down some points right now and make curves, and you want the curve to look a certain way, and it just isn't doing what you want. And that, I mean, this is the hardest skill in Illustrator, I think. So don't give up. Just keep trying it, and I think eventually you'll be able to use the tool to some effect. But in the meantime, I think we're going to move on to the next tool that we need to learn about. Any questions about the... Yes. So like I said, the pin tool is really hard, but just start by drawing square corner points, just clicking and connecting those dots with the pin tool. And then from there, move up to making curved points by clicking and dragging and see how that works. Yes. All right, so some easier to understand tools now. That's like the hardest thing for today. The next thing we're going to learn about is the eyedropper tool. And the eyedropper tool allows you to take colors and appearances from one object and copy it onto another. So say that you have some font and you have some red font that you like, and then you want to copy that red font onto some font you just created. So you can highlight that red font, use the eyedropper tool, and then suck that appearance from the previous text onto the new. And it works for text, it works for fill colors, it works for strokes, it works for apparent transparency. It really works for anything that you could possibly want to copy from one object to the other. And so let's try that on our Illustrator file that's on Blackboard. You can see at the top here I have an object. It's a circle. It's got a black stroke and a white fill. If I select it with the direct select tool, that's V, and then click on it. If I use the eyedropper tool, which is I, you can see that the cursor has changed to this little eyedropper. And if I click on an object, then the selected object will inherit the properties, all of the appearances of the object that I just clicked on. And by default, it will take all of the properties of the other object. But if instead, maybe I just only want the blue color from the other object and not the entire appearance. You see there's kind of an orange stroke around that circle. If instead if I select a second circle by choosing the select tool with V and then clicking on it to select the second circle, if I switch the eyedropper tool with I, and then I hold down shift when I click the blue, instead of getting the entire appearance, I only get the blue color. And so maybe this is kind of the intuitive way you would expect the eyedropper tool to work. Oh, I just want the blue, so I'm going to click on the blue. So hold down shift if that's what you want. And so when you click on the eyedropper tool and hold shift, it takes the color of the active filler stroke. So I'm going to undo that. And so you see here that the fill color is selected here. Let me move that a little further. You can see that the fill color is in the foreground, so I'm changing the fill color. If I switch to the eyedropper tool, hold down shift, and click in the blue, it's going to put the blue in the fill color. If instead I have the stroke color in the foreground where I'm editing the stroke color, if I hold down shift and click in the blue, this blue goes onto the stroke instead of the fill. All right, and you can also take the stroke color and put it into the fill color of a different object. You just hold down shift and then click on the stroke, and now the stroke color goes into the fill. So when you hold shift, it takes the color of whatever you're clicking. And so this can be really handy if you're taking a color from a gradient. Say I don't know exactly what this color is right here because it's part of a continuum of a gradient. If I use the eyedropper tool and hold shift, it will take the color that is underneath the eyedropper tool and not take the gradient. So if I hold, why did it do that? Here. I think that's a smart guide problem. Yeah. Well, I can't tell you why it's not. Maybe some of you are trying it right now, and it is working. Yeah, see, Regis, see, yeah, it's working. I don't know why it's not working up here, but in general, if you click, hold down shift, it should take the color underneath your eyedropper. And you can also do this for pictures. Say you've got the BCM logo here, and you don't know exactly what color the BCM B is supposed to be. Right? But you can actually take that color by using the eyedropper tool and taking that color. All right, any questions about the eyedropper tool? Yes. Sorry. You know, it might be actually this click thing that I have on. Yes, that's what it is. So I have this this little mouse thing that when I click, it makes this blue color appear underneath the mouse click, and it was sampling that color. Sorry, guys. Such is life, right? All right. So moving on to the next topic. The shape tools. So the shape tools are kind of the bread and butter of what you're going to do, right? You're going to make a cell that you want to put on your figure, and you're going to need a circle to make that cell. So you're going to use the ellipse tool, right? Or you want to make some other shape, and you're going to use these shape tools. They come in three main types: the rectangle, the ellipse, and the polygon. And they can all be found under the same part of the tool palette. Probably has a rectangle on your tool palette. If you click and hold, you can see these different options. And all the tools basically work the same way. If you hold down shift, you get a proportional shape. So a proportional rectangle is a square. A proportional ellipse is a circle. If you hold down alt when you click, the shape will be centered around that point that you click, and then it will expand outward from there, as opposed to if you just click and drag, I don't know how it decides where that shape's going. And so if you try right now, you'll see how those are different. And so let's try to make some proportional shapes. We're going to start with a rectangle. The rectangle tool's right here. You can see if you don't have it there, it might be hidden by a different one. Just click in this position and select rectangle. If you click and drag, it will make a shape. And it's not proportional, it will make rectangles. If you hold down shift, it's going to make a square, right? Because it's perfectly proportional. All right, now let's watch what happens if I hold down alt when I click. It's going to start from the center and go outwards, as opposed to when I click and drag, who knows what it's doing. All right, and you can see that again. Hold down alt, it expands from the center, and if I hold down shift at the same time, now I'm making a proportional shape that expands from the center. All right, so I just made a square out from the center. So the same works for an ellipse. All right, hold down alt to expand from the center, hold down shift to make proportional. All right, sometimes that's not exactly where I wanted it. So what you can do is while you're still making the shape, just like we did for the pin tool, if you hold down space, now you can move that along the artboard. So really these sorts of keyboard shortcuts are kind of the same across the different tools, and so if you learn it once, then you know that same trick the next time. So again, if you click and hold down alt and shift, you're getting a proportional shape from the center. And if you hold down space, you can move that around the artboard. All right, so the one last one is the polygon tool, which makes shapes of any number of sides. So one way to change the number of sides is to click somewhere on the artboard with this tool selected. Now it has this dialog box that wants to ask you how many sides should I have. So I could add, five sides. Now I have a pentagon. Or alternatively, what I can do is I can click and drag. And you can see it's making five because that's the last number I put in there. But now if I hit the down key, decreases the number of sides down to a minimum of three. And if I push the up key, it will keep going until 100, I think. And so the same things we learned before, you can hold down space to move it around the artboard. And you can hold shift to make it proportional. Any questions about the shape tools? Great. All right, so now to get to the actual fun stuff today. We've learned all these basic tools. Why don't we learn how to put them together into something meaningful? Right? And so if you're like me, you don't know how to draw, but you can put a bunch of shapes together and combine that into something meaningful. So we're going to learn about the Shape Builder tool. The Shape Builder tool combines shapes that are just individual basic things that you made with the shape tools, and it combines them into something more complex. And so you can use this to draw something better. So we'll just move on to the next panel in our little folder file here, Shape Builder. So the first thing to use the Shape Builder, you have to select the shapes that you want to combine. So I'm going to select these shapes right here. You see that they're selected. I use the direct select tool, which is V. They're selected. Now I'm going to switch to the shape builder tool. Sometimes it's hidden behind a live paint bucket tool, but its keyboard shortcut is Shift M. It looks like two circles with an arrow. Shape builder tool. All right, and so now you can click and drag. You'll notice that this little arrow has a plus sign next to it. And so if I click and drag, it's going to combine the shapes that I moved the mouse through into one big shape. And so if I click inside this diamond and I move across into the square, it will now combine those into one shape. All right. So alternatively, you can select shapes, use the Shape Builder tool, and if I hold down Alt, instead of combining shapes, it will subtract the shapes from each other. You can see that the arrow now has a tiny little minus sign next to it. So if I click and drag through this space, it's going to subtract those shapes. So now I have a crescent moon. What can I do for you?
My Shape Builder tool has a circle with a cross through it, so I can't select anything.
Right, so you have to select with the direct select tool first by switching to V, and then select the shapes that you want to combine, and then switch to the Shape Builder tool, which is Shift M. So alternatively, you can get around this by holding down Control or Command, and now you have your direct select tool again. So you've got your Shape Builder tool right now, hold down Command, you've switched back to select, and now you can select those things, let go of Command, and you're back to the Shape Builder. So again, I'll hold down Alt, subtract instead of add, and then I'll move through the shapes I want to subtract. By default, it's plus, and if you hold down the Alt key, it's minus. I don't know if you can control that. Let me help you after class, okay? All right, so why don't we use this to actually make an interesting shape? So I've combined these shapes. I've put these shapes on here ahead of time. Let's go ahead and select all these ones I have here by holding down Control or Command or Control and highlighting all the shapes. I'm going to switch back to the Shape Builder tool with Shift M, and I can drag through these shapes to combine them, and I'm just going to get rid of all the lines on the inside. All right, and so if I switch back to select, now you can see that I've combined those shapes into a more complex shape. But I didn't actually have to know how to draw an Erlenmeyer flask, I just put the shapes together. Right? And so you'll notice that there's still a line up in the top where I want the opening of the Erlenmeyer flask to be. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight all these shapes. I'm going to switch to the Shape Builder tool with Shift plus M. And you see that I'm in regular plus mode of the Shape Builder tool. I'm going to hold down Alt to subtract paths, and I'm going to move through that line in the top. Whoops, that's not what I wanted to do. I'm going to click on that line because I don't want it to be there anymore. So now it's gone. All right, so now I have my very nice Erlenmeyer flask that I made out of two circles, a triangle, and a square. All right, so let's try that again, but with a falcon tube, okay? So what I have here, I have one circle, I have two circles, then I have a square, a longer square, a circle at the bottom, and then I use a line. You'll see that you can also use lines in addition to shapes. You can draw lines, and as long as it encloses an area, you can put those together with the Shape Builder tool. So what I've done is I've used the pen tool, which we learned about before. So I'm just going to start drawing a line here, and I'm going to connect it to the circle. And that finishes off my falcon tube. So I'm going to switch to select mode with V. I'm going to highlight all of these shapes. And now I'm going to combine them with the Shape Builder tool. So I'm just going to draw my line through things that I want to combine together. So I'm just going to combine these shapes together too. Very carefully get rid of the lines that I don't want. It's a little tricky at this zoom. I want to get rid of this part too. All right, so I also want to get rid of that line right there. So now I have a falcon tube. So I've combined these shapes together. Now I can apply color, right? So got this one right here. Maybe I want to use the eyedropper tool to select that orange color that I was using over here. I think that would look good on the top of the falcon tube. So I can select the shapes with the direct select tool, then I can eyedropper that color. All right, and so now I have my falcon tube. So do we have any questions about the shape builder? All right, so the next thing we're going to learn about is the live paint tool. And so the live paint tool really lets you paint by numbers. You're going to have some art, it's going to have some white spaces, and you can dump paint into those white spaces. And so the paint bucket tool applies something called swatches. And you'll remember we opened that panel called swatches earlier. And so what swatches allow you to do is to save a color as a little swatch that you're putting on your little panel that you're going to use later. And so the first thing we need to learn how to do is to make some swatches that we're going to paint with later. So let's go back to the Illustrator file. And I've made you these little colored squares so that you can borrow the colors. So what I want you to do is use the direct select tool with V, click on one of the squares, and go over to the swatches panel. All right. So I'll give you a chance to open the swatches panel in case you've somehow closed it since the beginning. Go to Window, Swatches. And so you should see something that looks sort of like this. And so on the bottom of the swatches panel, there's a little thing that looks like a page that's kind of flipped up a little bit at the bottom. And if you hover your mouse over it, it says new swatch. And so the new swatch will take whatever color is active here on the tool panel, tool palette here, which in this case is the fill color of the object that I just selected, which is the blue square. And if I click the new swatch, it's going to bring up this dialog box that has that swatch already on it. Now I could name this, I could name it blue or whatever I want, and hit OK. And so you'll see that that new color has appeared in the swatches panel. Is everybody following along with how we just made a new swatch? All right, so why don't we go ahead and repeat the process for the three other colors that I've provided there for you. So just click on it, click the new swatches button, hit OK. Now we've got purple, new swatches. Now we got yellow, red. Great. So now you should have four new swatches in your swatch panel. You can see that I've made two copies of them, which is going to be trouble for me later. So I'm just going to delete them by hitting the trash can. All right, so now that we have our four colors that we're going to paint with later, what we want to do is make a live paint object so we can actually paint. And so in order to make a live paint object, you need to select some artwork that you've already made, and you need to convert it to live paint. And so I have drawn this thing previously, and I provided it for you. And so next session, we're going to learn about live trace, which will help you speed up the process of drawing things. But for now, just use the one that I provided. So I've selected this artwork that I previously made, and now I'm going to switch to the Live Paint Bucket tool. And so if you'll recall, that's hidden under the Shape Builder tool. See, Live Paint Bucket. The shortcut key is K. And so then you just click on the selected artwork to convert it to Live Paint. So an alternative to that is you can go to Object, Live Paint, Make. All right, so now we have our live paint here. Now we want to put some colors on our live paint. So Those of you who have studied human embryology will know that in all the textbooks, the epiblast is colored blue, the mesoderm is colored red, and the endoderm is colored yellow. And so why don't we use those colors and paint our little primitive streak here? So if with the paint bucket tool still selected, I'm going to click on the blue swatch that I have in my library that we just created. And now I can just start painting in the little spots. And so you can see that the space that's going to be colored actually is highlighted in red. And if I click and drag across, I can paint a lot of things at once, which saves a lot of time. Now, if I want to paint a different color, you can see above the cursor here, there are little tiny swatches. And so the color that's in the center of the three swatches is the color that's going to be painted. If I use the left and right arrow keys, I can paint a different color. Maybe I want to paint red. So I'll hit the right arrow three times. Now you can see red is in the center of the three swatches above the cursor. So when I click, it's going to paint red. Oops.
How did you get your three
swatches? So when the paint bucket tool is active, there are three swatches above the paint bucket. You can see the swatch that occurs in the swatch panel in front of the swatch you're using and the swatch that's after the swatch you're using. And you might even be able to move the swatches around if you don't like the order. All right, so I've made a mistake and I've painted that white, or red. I want it to go back to being no fill. So I'm going to click no fill and put it back. So that's the great thing about the live paint bucket. You can just paint across in whatever color you want and then go back to your swatches and start painting a different color. So you can see it can be quite fast, save a lot of time, rather than trying to select each one individually and change the fill. Any question about the paint bucket tool? Great. All right, so the next thing we're going to talk about is gradients. And I am a member of the anything looks better with a gradient camp. What can I do for you?
So can you tell us how we can reorganize what those four colors are on our...
Sure, so the four colors are not actually any way tied to the paint bucket. They just happen to be in the swatches panel in that order. You can actually move these swatches around into an order that you prefer so that they're next to each other on the paint bucket, so that they'll be available for you to paint with. Great question. All right, and so I really like gradients. Some people think that gradients are overused, but I think gradients are a great way to make your artwork look a little bit more professional. And so the way you edit gradients in Illustrator is with a gradient panel. So we opened it earlier, but in case you've somehow closed it, we'll go to Window, Gradient, and it looks something like this. And so one problem that even to this day I run into is I'll be messing around with my gradient, making it look just perfect, and then I realized that I didn't have an object selected, so nothing was actually getting that gradient that I was making. And so when I click on an object, that gradient goes away, and I'm really sad because I spent like 15 minutes making it perfect. So click an object before you start messing with gradient. Or alternatively, remember to hit the new swatches. But just select an object first. And so you'll see here on the gradient, there are really three main things you need to worry about. There's the type of gradient, either radial out from the center or linear, which starts at one point and goes all the way across. All right. Then if you are in linear gradient mode, then you've got the angle. And so you can see that this one goes from white to black, left to right. But maybe I want it to go from top to bottom. And so to do that, I would select 90 degrees. And you can have any number in between, I think. All right. And so then the final thing is sort of this gradient slider part of the panel. And this is where you actually put colors to make your gradient. So you can see that there's white on one side and black on the other. But you can have any number of colors on this gradient that you want. and you can just drag them out of the swatches panel that we were using before into the gradient. So maybe I want an orange on here, so I'll just drag the orange out of the swatches and into the gradient. And I really like blue, so I'm going to put blue on the other side. Now I have an orange to blue gradient. And you can move these sliders around to make just the right sort of tone across the shape. And you can, you see that on the top of the gradient bar here, there's a little sort of diamond. And you can move this back and forth, which can controls the midpoint between the two colors. Sure. So let's start with the good old-fashioned white to black. All right. So we're going to select our object here. We can control the type, whether it's linear or radial, from the panel there that says type, and then you select one. If it's linear, you can change the angle with this little thing that shows an angle. And then if you want to change the colors, you can just drag colors out of your swatches into the bottom part of this line that describes the gradient. So I'm just clicking, dragging, and then dropping it into the bottom. So another way that you can change the color is you see there are these little squares underneath the gradient. If I double click that, then it'll bring up the color picker, and I can manually pick a color. And so we've thus far only seen two colors on our gradient. We can add as many as we want. So maybe I want red in the middle. Now I have a three-color gradient. And so just like regular swatches, we can also make gradient swatches so that we can use the same gradient over and over again. So just like we did before, maybe we really like this linear gradient. We just push the new swatch button. Just call it my gradient. And you can see that there's now a swatch that has that gradient in it on your swatches panel.
If you create a gradient swatch, is it saved for future sessions?
It's only saved in the current Illustrator. The question was, is this gradient now saved across all of Illustrator? And the answer is no. You can export the swatches as a library, which you can later load, but that's outside the scope of this course. All right, and so now that I have made that swatch, if I create a new shape, I can apply that swatch and have that same gradient right on there. All right. Any question about gradients?
What are the three stroke functions on the gradient? One, it says it's along the stroke, across the stroke.
Right, so his question is about these little buttons that appear right here. I've actually never used those, but I will assume that if I draw a line, which has a stroke on it, right? We'll make it really big so you can see it. I can actually apply that gradient to the stroke. Drag it right onto the stroke, and you can see that now the gradient is on the stroke rather than the fill. And I bet if you click those buttons, it will change the way couldn't tell you. Sorry. There's a lot of stuff about Illustrator that I don't know. Any other questions? So his question was, how many colors can you put on a gradient? I think I've had like 8 or 10. You could probably put let's just try. So you can see a lot will go on there. Yes. You cannot change the number of sides on a polygon after you've made it, fortunately. Yes. So you can't automatically, but there's actually a number. If you click on this box, you'll see the location actually appears underneath. You see it says 5.7. So you just divide the number of, yep. All right. Good question. I've actually had to do the dividing manually. Yeah. All right, so now that we've learned about gradients, it's time to really put what we've learned into making something that looks really professional. And so a lot of times people will be like, oh, I have SMAD2, it interacts with, you know, this kinase. So I'm going to draw a circle and I'm going to label it SMAD2. Let's not make it that color, but you know what I mean. All right. All right, so now I'm all done. That's SMAD2. But wouldn't it be great if you could actually take something that's known about the science and make it into art? And so one of the things I like to do is get the crystal structure of the protein that you're actually trying to model. So I went to the PDB and I downloaded the crystal structure, IKHX if you're interested. And now I'm going to model my model of SMAD2 against the crystal structure. All right? And so I have the crystal structure here. Now I'm going to use the pencil tool, which we haven't used yet. It's hidden right here. It looks like a pencil. The keyboard shortcut is in. And now I'm going to draw a shape around this crystal structure. And I'm going to be a little stylistic because nobody likes a plain blob. So I'm just going to draw a circle around my SMAD crystal structure here. And now it's really hard to get these pencil tools to close. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold down Alt. And now there's a circle next to the pencil tool. Now it's going to help me and automatically close this path. All right, so now I have a circle that I drew around this crystal structure of SMAD2. And that looks really jagged to me. It doesn't look like natural and something that I'd want to put in a paper. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to simplify it. So this is like a little trick. If you made something that's a little too jagged, what you can do is you can go to Object, Path, Simplify. This isn't the PowerPoint presentation, but it is written on the Illustrator file. Object, the path that we just made is selected. Object, Path, Simplify. All right, and so you can control how much simpler it's going to get with this little slider here. That looks good. All right. And since I'm OCD, I don't really much care for that right there. All right, much better. All right, so here you can see my path. It looks somewhat like that SMAD2 crystal structure a little bit. So let's start with a color that is going to represent SMAD2 for us. So I'm going to go back to my swatches panel, which we had open before. Got swatches here. I'm going to pick this nice deep red. That looks like a good color for a protein. And so now we're going to take what we learned about gradients and we're going to apply it to this blob to make a 3D effect. So to do that, what we can do is we can go to Object, Create Gradient Mesh. So this is going to allow me to put gradients all over the object rather than across the entire object. So when I click this button, going to ask how many rows and columns I want. So I'm going to put 6 rows and 6 columns. And for this exercise, I'm going to put the highlight at 0. So you can see here, I've got preview checked. So it's going to show me how many lines are going to go on this mesh. So you can see there are 6 columns and 6 lines. I think that's OK. So I'm going to hit OK. So now you can see there's this mesh over the blob that we just made around our crystal structure.
What did you have appearance set to?
What did I have appearance set to? to center. I think that's the default. I don't think it actually does anything unless highlight's set to a non-zero number. All right, so now we've got our gradient mesh. And so the way that gradient meshes work is that you are going to highlight individual points in that mesh, and then you can apply colors, and it will make a gradient between that point and the other points. So maybe I want a little bit of shadow on my protein. So I'm going to highlight these points down where I want to be a shadow, and now I'm going to apply a darker color. And so this is the tricky part. What you can do is you can either just know what you're doing, or you can try to pick a color out of the color spectrum. That's really, really hard, let me tell you. But if you have the color panel, here we go. So if we select a color, we can see that in CYMK mode, the K stands for contrast, I think. And so this slider will make it darker and darker. So we've got those points selected. If we move, you might be in RGB mode. If you're in RGB mode, click on those four horizontal lines and switch to CYMK mode. So we're looking at the CYMK color picker, and we're going to increase the K value here to get a shadow effect on our blob. All right, and so to recap, I'm selecting points on this gradient mesh. I've selected it with V. Now I'm going to use the lasso tool Q, and I'm going to draw a circle around some points here that I want to make darker. And then I'm just going to turn up the darkness to get a shadow effect. So you can see that it creates a gradient between those points that I've selected and the rest of the object. So maybe I want a little more shadow, so I'll select here. And I'll add a little darkness. So you can see that we're starting to make a 3D effect. So we put... Gotcha. It looks really nice on my screen. So now you can start to see these darker colors. I'm going to turn this one up too. All right, and so I put some shadows on the bottom, like the light is coming from the top. Now I'm going to add some lighter colors to the top of the blob. To do that, instead of turning up the K value, I'm going to turn it down. And it might be a little tricky to make it much lighter than that. Now we're talking. Can you see that it's lighter there now, a little bit? Sorry. So sometimes having the color mode, the color palette in a different color mode can help you pick colors better. The default is in CYMK mode, but you can't get any more light than K equals zero. And so if we switch to HSB mode, then we can change S to lighter and lighter. We can save these colors to swatches so that we can use them later. So I can make this entire top of the blob a lighter color now. Yeah, that's not really helping. But just try some lighter colors to get that kind of 3D effect. You can see an example of it down at the bottom, where on your screen it'll probably look better, that there's sort of a darker color on the bottom of the shape and then a lighter color on the top. And you can use these gradient meshes to apply this 3D effect. So let's try a little more complicated example on the next panel, Gradient Mesh Part 2. And so I downloaded a picture of a human embryo from the Carnegie Foundation website, and I outlined it with the pen tool, and I've provided that to you next to the picture. And so we'll learn in next week's class how to use the live trace tool to do this automatically. But I just drew it with the pen tool, and after hours of practice, maybe you can too, But I've already made it for you. So what we can do is we can go to Object, Create Gradient Mesh. And so instead of having six, let's select a color that's kind of a good base color first. So I'm going to select this path that's already on the artboard with the select tool, which is V. Then I'm going to use the eyedropper tool, and I'm going to sample a pink color from this image by just clicking on it. All right, looks like a good color. Now I'm going to switch back to the select tool, V again, and I'm going to make the gradient mesh. Object, create gradient mesh. And I'm going to have 6 rows and 20 columns. 20 columns and 6 rows. And so I'm going to let Illustrator do some of the work for me. And I'm going to turn on highlight. So I'm going to set this at 80. So you can see, if you do this on your screen, you'll see that the center, because we have the appearance set to center, the center is going to be highlighted. So it's a brighter color. All right, so I'm happy with those results. And so if I click off of it, you can see that the center of this embryo shape is now brighter. And so it's already looking a lot better. So what if I want to make the shadow? You can see here that there's a shadow on the embryo's arm, right? And so I want to recreate that shadow here too. And so I'm going to zoom in to where the arm is. I'm going to select it. And now I can highlight, I can direct select those individual anchor points that will be behind the embryo's arm with the lasso tool. So I just selected 3 in a row that will be behind the embryo's arm. And now I'm going to make it just a little bit dark. So you can see that adds a little bit of depth to the arm. And I'm going to do the same thing with the leg. You can see that there are mesh points down here near the leg. I'm going to select those 2 right there to be the shadow. And then I'm going to use the eyedropper tool to select the color that I already applied. And now I've applied that same color to those points at the bottom. And so you can see already that it's starting to look much more like an embryo, right? And so if we look back at the original image, you can see that there's sort of a darker part on the top here, like the shadow, the light is coming from the bottom. So I'm going to select those at the top. And then I'm going to use the eyedropper to select kind of a darker color. I'm going to apply that to the top. It may be somewhat difficult to see, I guess, and then I'm going to look back at the original photo and see if there are any other darker spots. So maybe there's a little bit darker here. So I'm going to go back to my gradient mesh. I'm going to use the lasso tool to select those points there. Then I'll use the eyedropper to select darker color in the back. So then one final finishing touch, you know, there's an eye on the embryo here, so I'll just draw a circle. I'm going to steal the color from the eye, the eyedropper. Now we have our embryo. Didn't look so bad. Oops. All right. Any questions about the gradient mesh tool? So you can actually move, if you look in really close at that gradient mesh, you can see there are little points here, and we selected ones to apply color. We can actually move those points around with the direct select tool. But getting them to look anything rational is really hard. So to start, just use the automatically created mesh and try to apply colors from there. All right, the final piece of that we're going to learn about today is the Live Recolor tool. And you spent a lot of time, you made some great artwork, but you want it to be a different color, and you don't want to have to go back and change every little piece. So there's, thankfully, a Live Recolor tool. So maybe I want a green cell instead of a blue cell, or a yellow cell instead of a blue cell. So I'm going to select the cell here with the Direct Select tool, and I'm going to go to Edit, Edit Colors, Recolor Artwork. This is a really complicated toolbox, but we don't really want what the assign. We want to click Edit here in the center. So it changes it to this color wheel. And then we don't want to have to change each one manually, so we're going to click this little chain link here. I'm just going to link them together. So to recap, I've gone to Edit, Edit Colors, Recolor Artwork. Now I have the Recolor Artwork dialog box. I'm going to push the Edit button right here, the Edit tab. And then I've clicked the Link Harmony Colors. And so now when I move one of them, all the other ones are going to move with it. So if we look back at our cell, we will see that it has changed colors. And if you don't like pink, how about orange? If you don't like orange, how about green? And so that can be really helpful, you know, okay, so I just made myself a green cell. Maybe I'd like a yellow cell now. So I'll just make a copy and I'll recolor it. Edit Colors, Recolor Artwork, Edit, Link. Super handy, and would be really hard to do if you didn't know those two little button presses. All right, so today I hope I've showed you some things that you can put together what you've learned to make some actual artwork that you could use in your everyday life. Next week, we're going to learn about the Live Trace tool. Hopefully, I'll have a microphone so you can hear me better, and we'll talk about how not to steal other people's artwork and get in trouble for it, and we'll also, I guess I will take volunteers to make me Live Trace something in front of you, and either I will wow you or I will fail miserably and you'll all laugh. So I hope to see you next week. Thanks for coming.